بسم الله. بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Welcome in this place Virginia Masjid, and I'm really appreciate this kind invitation to be here with you. And I would like to thank all brothers and sisters in this community, and also would like to thank Al-Tadhkira Institute for their effort in the community, not only here but in every state in Australia, and also thanks IBCD here as well as and other states. So I'm here today, inshallah. As we know, we are in the months of Sha'ban, month of Sha'ban. And month of Sha'ban is a preparation for Ramadan. And if you are not able to practice on Sha'ban, it will be dangerous and you are not able to practice the fasting in Ramadan. And in this short program, which only in Sha'ban, maybe 4 lessons, inshallah, I would like to summarize the beneficial summary of the fasting rules. And this summary I learned from my Sheikh, Dr. Khalid ibn Mahmoud al-Juhani, a lecture in the University of Safwa, School of Sharia and Arabic language. And I got from him an ijaza to teach this book. The book is called Al-Mukhtasar Al-Mufid Fi Ahkam Al-Siyam Wa Adab Al-Eid, the beneficial summary in the fasting rules and the etiquette of the Eid. So during this course, we will go through this book and explain, as my Sheikh explained to me before, explain to you inshallah, how can we fast according to Sunnah al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How can we practice the fasting according to the Sahaba? And what is the beneficial or the benefits and the advantage of fasting? And what is, or how many types of fasting? And what is the condition and the pillars of fasting? And what is the voluntary action of fasting? And also what is recommended to do in the month of Ramadan in terms of ibadah, like in terms of salah, in terms of reading Quran, in terms of charity. And also we explain about i'tikaf, and also about Laylatul Qadri, the night of destiny, and how can we recognize Laylatul Qadri, and what is the importance of Laylatul Qadri. And also we will explain the ruling of Zakatul Fitri, a charity of breaking fast, and what we should do in order to practice Sunnah al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let us start quickly by this beautiful book, Al-Mukhtasar Al-Mufid Fi Ahkam Al-Siyam Wa Adab Al-Eid, the beneficial summary in the fasting rules and the adab, the manners of Eid. قال المصنف حفظه الله. First chapter, فضائل شهر رمضان وفضائل الصيام وبما يستقبل شهر رمضان. So in this chapter we talk about what is the advantages of the fasting and what is the advantages of the month of Ramadan. And how can we prepare ourselves for Ramadan? How can we make sure that we are ready for Ramadan? طيب. If we talk about the month of Ramadan, just one second. The month of Ramadan is one of the months of Islamic months. We have 12 months in Islam. Four of these months called the sacred months, Al-Ashhur Al-Hurm. And these four months is Rajab, Dhul-Qi'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, and Al-Muharram. Three in sequence, Dhul-Qi'dah, Dhul-Hijjah, and Al-Muharram, and one Rajab. And Ramadan is the month of the fasting, and all of you know that it is compulsory for the person to fast in Ramadan with condition, as we explain. First advantage of fasting. One of the advantage of fasting that anyone who fasts one day for the cause of Allah Azza wa Jal, what happened to him? Allah Azza wa Jal will separate his face from the hellfire by distance approximate 70 years. If you fast one day for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal will separate your face from the hellfire about 70 autumn or 70 years. Also, one of the benefit of fasting, إِنَّ لِلْجَنَّةِ بَابًا يسمى الريان. In the Jannah, there is a bab, a door called الريان. لا يدخله إلا الصائمون. Only the people who observe fasting will enter through this door. وإذا دخلوا يغلق. And then when they enter, it will be closed. So every person who observes fasting, any kind of fasting, either voluntary fasting or the month of Ramadan, anyone observe the fasting, he will enter the Jannah through a specific door or specific gate called الريان, باب الريان. أيضا من فوائد أو من فضائل الصوم, one of the advantages of the fasting, that the person who have afflictions in his family, afflictions, trials in his wealth, afflictions in his children, all these afflictions will be removed by charity, by fasting, by prayer. So this is also reason to resolve your hardship, to resolve your any disaster that you have, to resolve any trials that you are with your family, with the children, with your wife, or whatever. So also Hadith al-Qudusi, that Allah said that He will reward for fasting by Himself. And this is the only ibadah that Allah mentions that He will give the reward by Himself to the person who fasts. And also in Hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أنه قال للصائم فرحتان عند فطره وعند لقاء ربه. So the person who observes fasting has two enjoying, two happiness. The first one, when he break his fast and see, look to anyone who break the fast, how is his feeling? And all of us know this feeling. When you break the fast, you're very happy. And also when you go to last destination, when you meet Allah Azza wa Jal, this will be also happiness because you will see what is the reward of the fasting. طيب. This is more likely most of the benefit and the advantages of fasting. طيب. What about Ramadan advantages? Because Ramadan is fasting compulsory. But before we explain the month of Ramadan and the advantages of Ramadan, I would like to give you an historical view of the fasting. How was the fasting previously? In the beginning of Islam. At the beginning of Islam, the fasting is commanded on the Medina after Hijrah. And when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Al-Medina from Mecca, he saw the Jewish, the Yahud, fasting the month or the day of Ashura, the 10th of Al-Muharram. And he asked them, not because he didn't know why they are fasting, this month or this day, but in order to give them or put them the evidence that they are come from the same source. He said to them, why you are fasting this day? And they said, because we thank Allah because he saved Musa from Pharaoh, from Fir'aun. And then he said, I have the right toward Musa more than you. And then he start to fast and command the Muslim to fast. And Rubay' bint Mu'awwad, one of the Sahabiyat, said that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent a caller, a person to call for the people that today is 10 of Muharram, Ashura means, and you have to fast. So anyone, and he said, anyone wake up in the morning and he already didn't eat, keep going until the end of the day, until the sunset. And anyone who eat or ate, also stopped eating and continuing to the end of the day. And Al-Rawai' ibn Mu'awwaz mentioned that in the month or in the day of Ashura, the boys and the girls, the children, the kids, practice fasting. And because it's very hard for them to start fasting at this age, and they start to cry. And the Sahaba prepared for them a doll from wool and give it to them, so they will busy with playing with a doll and finish the fasting. So this, from this hadith we have some lessons. First, if someone start his day and he didn't know that today is fasting, he can continue fasting. I give an example. If you, on the night of the last night of Sha'ban, and you went to sleep before you know what about the moon sighting, is it confirmed tomorrow is Ramadan or not? And you put an intention in yourself that if tomorrow Ramadan, I will fast. If no Ramadan, I will not fast. And you wake up in the morning and someone informed you that tomorrow or today is Ramadan, and you didn't put intention from the previous night, you keep fasting because you already put intention from the last night that if Ramadan today, I will be fast. Also from this hadith, we can learn that from Sunnah to practice fasting with the kids, to let the kids practice fasting. And it is forced, if they are responsible for fasting, they are not will be accounted for fasting, but they have to practice. Because if they become a mature without practicing the fasting, it's very hard for them to fasting. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fi hijjat al-wada' ra'a mra'atan tahujju bi tifliha farafa'athu ila al-a'la faqalat ya rasul Allah هل على هذا حج؟ قال نعم ولك أجر. On the Hajjat al-Wada, the farewell Hajj, one mother holding a baby, a boy, to the top and show it to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Prophet, is there a Hajj on this boy? Is a young boy, and he said yes, and you will take reward to let him do Hajj. So also you as a parent, if you let your kids practice the fasting, you will take the reward, even they are not accounted or accounting for this fasting. طيب, this is the beginning of fasting on the 10th of Muharram, was a compulsory at the beginning. And then what happened? When the Ramadan has been described by revelation of Ayat Surah Al-Baqarah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Oh, who you believe, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ Fasting has been described on you. كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ As has been prescribed on previous nation. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ So you gain the taqwa, the fear from Allah Azza wa Jal. So it become compulsory to fast Ramadan and become optional to fast the 10 of Muharram. طيب. Even at the beginning of the Ramadan, it passes through stages. It does not comes like that we have. What we have now, it is compulsory for the person, a mature, an adult, a Muslim, a mindful, a resident in a place, healthy, and avoid from female restriction. It is compulsory for him or her to fast from dawn to sunset. But at the beginning, it was an option. How it's option? At the beginning, Allah said in the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, the same verse of the prescription of the fasting, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينَ فَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَأَنْ تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And anyone who has a hardness in fasting, he has an option to feed a poor person instead of fasting. But it is better for him to fast. So it was optional at the beginning, either to fast or to feed a needy person per day. And then after this verse, the next verse, it become compulsive. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم. And the month of Ramadan, when the Quran has been revealed, فمن شهد, who attend or who saw the beginning of the month, he have to fast. This is the second stage. And then in this stage also, there are two stages inside this stage. First stage, anyone who went to sleep before sunset, he cannot break his fast until the next stage. One Sahabi went from his work before Maghrib and he asked his wife to prepare the iftar and he went to sleep. He was sitting but he went to sleep accidentally, unintentionally. Then he wake up after Maghrib and according to the rule, he should stay for the next day, Maghrib. And then he dropped on the next day on the street and then Allah Azza wa Jal revealed a verse that وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. So and eat and drink until you recognize the white thread from the black thread. Stop. The verse stop on that. Allah didn't reveal yet مِنَ الْفَجْرِ, from the Fajr. And one Sahabi, his name عَدِي بن حَاتِمِ الطَّائِي. عَدِي was a Christian and he accepted Islam after that. And at the beginning, he didn't understand the meaning of the verse. What he did, Adi, he bring a white thread and a black thread and he put it in front of his bed in the dark because there is no light on this time. And he keep eat and drink, but he cannot distinguish between the white thread and the black thread because there is dark. Then he realized that the Fajr start, the light of the day start. And then he went to Prophet Muhammad and he said to him, oh Prophet, I keep two threads, one white and one black, and keep eating and drinking, and still I cannot recognize between them because of the darkness. And then the Fajr came, and then Prophet Muhammad smiled, and then he explained, this ayah means that you eat and drink until you recognize the white of the day, means the light of the day, from the dark of the night, which is the true Fajr. So this is the second or the third stage and it become compulsory as we have now. So this is the history of the prescription of the fasting. And the month of Ramadan especially has an advantages over any other fasting. Hadith Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu anna an-Nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa sallam qala man sama رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. And whoever fasts the month of Ramadan with a belief and considering the reward from Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Azza wa Jal will forgive and erase all the previous sins. And in another hadith, الصلوات الخمس والجمعة إلى الجمعة ورمضان إلى رمضان مكفرات لما بينهم إذا اجتنم الكبائر. The five daily salah in between the daily salah and Jum'ah to Jum'ah, Ramadan to Ramadan, if you practice these actions, all your sins will be forgiven between this timing, except the major sins, except the major sins. And what is the major sins, by the way? We need to know how can you recognize and identify this sins is a major or a minor. It's very important. Type. The major sins have some features. It has penalties, Islamic penalties, had. Like for example, stealing. In Islam, there are penalties of the stealing. Zina, adultery, have also. Drinking alcohol has also penalties. So any penalties or any sin that has Islamic penalties, this will be a major sin. Any sins that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam cursed the person who do or does this sin, he will also be a major. Or Allah Azza wa Jalla curses the person who does these sins, he also a major. Or Allah Azza wa Jalla explain the Quran, there will be a severe punishment for the person who do such and such. This means the major sin. Also, if Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam specify this is a major sins, like hadith, اجتنوا السبع المهلكات, so stay away from the seven destructive sins: الشرك بالله والسحر and magic والزنا adultery وأكل الربا consuming of interest or riba والتولي يوم الزحف and escaping from the battlefield وعقوق الوالدين mistreat of your parent. Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم specify these sins as major sins, so it is a major sins. طيب, what is the ruling of the person who commit major sins? كل بني آدم خطاؤون وخير الخطائين التوابون. Every son of Adam is a sinful, is commit sins, and the best sinful person who repent to Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is a clear for everyone, and Allah will not open the door of repentance for anyone who return to Him. إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. Allah does not forgive a shirk, but He will forgive anything other than shirk, other than associate with Allah someone else in ibadah. Since you are not doing shirk, all the things are easy, but return to Allah Azza wa Jal. And a Muslim who commit major sin and he didn't repent to Allah Azza wa Jal in the dunya, or he didn't receive an Islamic penalties or had in the dunya, what happened to him? He is still Muslim, and he will be under the mashi'ah, the will of Allah Azza wa Jal in the hereafter. He may be punished him or may be forgive him, but he's still Muslim. He a weak Muslim because he commit ma'asiyah or sins, major sins, but still under the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal, since he believe in Allah and his prophet and he pray and he do all the sign of Islam. So this is the advantage of the fasting, that from Ramadan to Ramadan, it will remove all the sins between Ramadan to Ramadan except the major sins. In order to remove the major sins, you have to first, if this major sin related to the persons, you have to return the right to this person. If you steal for someone, you have to return the money to someone. If you do a magic for someone, you have to resolve this magic for this person. So everything you have to resolve it in order to gain the forgiveness from Allah Azza wa Jal if it is related to the others. طيب. Also, one of the advantages of Ramadan, that if you attend Umrah in Ramadan, is equal to Hajj in reward. And in one narration, Hajj with Prophet. After Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished his farewell Hajj, because he did only one Hajj, and he did four Umrah. The first Umrah was the Umrah بيعة الرضوان on the sixth hijrah. When he went to Mecca, he saw a dream that he will enter Mecca with the Sahaba wearing ihram. And then he went, but the kuffar and the mushrikeen stopped him, and they did a pledge or agreement that they return for the next year. So the first one, بيع حجة الرضوان or حجة الحديبية, صلح الحديبية. When they have agreement in Hudaybiyah, then in 7 Hijrah, the next year, he came with the Sahaba to do Hajjatul Qada, compensation of the previous year Hajj. And then after Hunayn battle, he went from Al-Ja'rana to do Umratul Ja'rana. And the last Umrah was with Hajj. So Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did 4 Umrah. All this Umrah in Zul Qi'dah. And then he saw, after he finished his Hajj, he saw one woman from the Ansar, and he didn't see her in the Hajj. And he tried to, يعني, said to her, you can still compensate it. And he said to her, فَإِذَا جَاءَ رَمَضَانَ فَاعْتَنِرِي فَإِنَّ عُمْرَةً فِيهِ تَعْدِلُ حَجَّ. And he told her, wait for Ramadan and go for Umrah, because doing Umrah in Ramadan equivalent to Hajj in reward, but it will not compensate the Hajj if it's compulsory on you. And as you can see, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam always try to give the best for his ummah, male and female. So he saw the Ansariya, or the woman from Ansar, was sad because she missed the Hajj. You know why she missed? Another narration, she said that this woman has a husband, and they have 2 camels. One used to do it in the house keeping or household purposes, and she cannot use for travel. And the other one, her husband went for Hajj, and she was very sad because she wanted to go with Prophet. And when Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم returned, he felt that she sad, and he said to her, okay, you can go for Umrah in Ramadan and be equivalent for the Hajj. So this is also the importance of doing Umrah in Hajj. Also in the Ramadan, there is a night called Laylatul Qadri. The translation of Laylatul Qadri, it is not night of Bawa. And this is the problem of the translation. When you translate the Arabic word, you will not able to find an equivalent word that covers the meaning. Laylatul Qadri, the correct translation, or the approximate correct translation, is the night of destiny, Al-Qadr. You know why? Because in this night, Allah Azza wa Jal descend the Qadr of the year, the destiny of the year, who will die, who will travel, who will go to the Hajj. This will be on the night of destiny. So in this night, the ibadah is more than 1,000 months in Surah Al-Qadr. Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alf shahr. More better than ibadah of 1,000 months, which is about 83 years. So if you pray 2 rak'ah in this night, it's like you pray these 2 rak'ah for more than 83 years. And we explain in this course how we can fill and how can we recognize the Laylatul Qadri from the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. طيب, as you can see, the month of Ramadan is have a lot of excellences, a lot of advantages, a lot of benefits. And you have to prepare yourself for Ramadan. Are you ready for Ramadan? Inshallah, we're ready, inshallah. طيب. How can you prepare yourself for Ramadan? By the way, if you look to the word Ramadan, it is an Arabic word from Ramada. Ramada means hot, because it used to come on the summer on this time, and the weather will very hot in this time, And the Arab called Ramadan, the month of Ramadan, is the month of the hot summer. طيب, Ramadan, how can you prepare yourself for Ramadan? التوبة النصوح الصادقة sincere, honest repentance. These three conditions. Sincere, honest repentance. التوبة النصوح الصادقة. Every word you have to stop and ask yourself, how can I apply this word in my life? توبة, from تاب يتوب, means عادة, return. توبة has conditions. Repentance has condition. First, you realize that you are did something wrong, and you promise yourself and your Lord that you will not return to this wrong. And if there is someone who affected by this wrong, you have to compensate this for him. This is the shurut al-tawbah. And also try to increase your righteous deed in order to compensate the bad deed that you did. So, al-nasuh, sincere. This tawbah should be only to Allah Azza wa Jalla. Some people do tawbah just to for the people. I commit any sins and just I do tawbah because people, I'm shy from the people. I cannot stay with this community doing these sins. So I will stop these sins because the people accuse me and say me about me. I'm a fasiq, I'm a asi, I'm a disobedience and so on and so on. This is, should not be the case. You have to be sincere to Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you be honest with yourself. Honest with yourself that you try to not return to the sins that you did. And by the way, if you return, again, do tawbah. Return, again, do tawbah. But you have to isolate yourself from the corruption. Remove yourself from the corruption environment that may return you back again for the ma'asiyah. And by the way, everyone, including myself, commit sins. This is the human nature. But the purposes of the sins is to repent to Allah Azza wa Jal. طيب. التوبة النصوح الصادقة. Sincere, honest repentance. First step before fasting, try to have sincere repentance and honest. بر الوالدين. To look after for your parent. And even your parent is passed away. Because إذا مات العبد انقطع عمله إلا من ثلاث صدقة جارية وعلم ينتفع به وولد صالح يدعو له. If the person died, his عمل will stop, he disconnected, except three will increase his عمل. Ongoing charity. And the best charity that you can do it, to build the masjid, that place of worship, to establish a place of prayer, to teach or to leave a knowledge that any other one can get benefit for that. This is the best ongoing charity. Either build a masjid or build or have established a will for water, any kind of thing for the people also will be important. أو ولد صالح يدعو له, a righteous boy or girl, of course, make dua. And here is the point. Before Ramadan, look after your parent. If they're still alive, go to their place, kiss their feet, their hand, and look after for them. If you are far from them, at least give them call. And if they are in the grave, if you can able to visit them in the grave, or make dua for them and do charity on behalf of them, this also one of the important things that you should do it before Ramadan. Before Ramadan, you have to stop the dispute with your brothers, and you have to stop and resolve any conflict, any problem between you and your brother, and have a clean sheet at Ramadan. Also, before Ramadan, you have to learn the rules of fasting, And because of that, we have this course. Before Ramadan, you will learn a lot about the condition of fasting, the sunan of fasting, what things that break fast and what thing that does not break fast. And because if you do not know the rules of fasting, you will stay the day of fasting confused. For example, I made a wudu and some water enter inside my mouth. What I should do? Should I keep fasting or not? I have a medicine. I got an injection. I go to the doctor. Such and such. All these questions will be in your mind and you are not enjoying the fasting. So you have to learn what thing breaks your fast and what thing does not break your fast. One more thing about the fasting, the definition of fasting. قال العلماء الصوم هو الإمساك عن المفطرات أو الإمساك عن الأشياء مخصوصة في وقت مخصوص من شخص مخصوص بنية مخصوصة. Fasting is abstain from specific things, eating and drinking and relation with between wife and husband. And for a specific timing, from the dawn time to sunset time. For a specific person, the one who eligible for fasting, Muslim, عاقل, mindful, and adult, resident, not traveler, and also should free from restriction, female restriction, menstrual cycle, or the post-bleeding, pregnancy bleeding, all this cannot fast, and also one of the condition, healthy. And by the way, and they're very important, and you have to know that. There are two types of illness or ill. Chronic one and acute one. For example, acute one, headache, spasm, back pain, all these kind of thing, it is acute, means it is well finished. In this case, if you are not able to fast, you can break your fast, but you have to compensate it after Ramadan. But what about if someone have a chronic disease? Heart failure, liver cirrhosis, diabetes, kidney failure, every kind of this chronic disease. And the doctor advised, an honest doctor advised him, you cannot fast, otherwise it will be dangerous. And he cannot fast. What he should do? What he should do? In this case, you apply the verse Allah said, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah would not burden a soul over its capacity. This is his capacity. So nothing on him. Even feeding a maskeen for one day each person, or one maskeen for each day, this is an option, not a compulsory. Abdullah ibn Abbas gives this fatwa that you can feed one maskeen if you're not able to fast permanently because you have a chronic disease. And Anas al-Malik did that as well. So fasting has a preparation, التوبة النصوح الصادقة, repentance, sincere, honest repentance, looking after your parent, and also remove any dispute between you and your brother, and also learn the ruling of fasting. طيب, let us start talking about what is the condition of fasting and who should fast. First, we just mentioned he should be Muslim. So fasting of the kafir will not accept it, and should be adult. Fasting of the immature boy or girl, it's invalid, but it is kind of practice, and the parent will reward for that. Also, should be resident, not traveler. You are in your hometown. This is, if you are in hometown, you have to fast. Also, the ability to fast, health ability to fast. If you have a health condition, depends on the health condition, you may either compensate after Ramadan or may you do nothing. If you are not able to fast, if you want to feed one maskeen per day, you can, otherwise nothing to do. And also for sisters, they should avoid or should free from their cycle, and if they delivery a baby, should the bleeding after pregnancy should be stopped. Types of fasting. How many types of fasting? Before we go through the pillars of fasting, how many types of fasting? What do you think? We have compulsory wajib fasting, and we have optional mandub fasting, sunnah fasting. Again, we have wajib and mandub or sunnah. Who can tell me example of the wajib fasting? What is the example of the wajib fasting? Ramadan, of course, easiest way. What else? What do you think? Tricky, not easy. Fine. I will give you an example and you can give me more. In Hajj and Umrah. In Hajj and Umrah. One of the requirement of the person who combine Hajj and Umrah, and maybe in the future when we come to the month of the Hajj, maybe prepare a course for Hajj and Umrah, inshallah, here again, inshallah, but when the time of Hajj, inshallah, come. So Hajj and Umrah, if you combine Hajj and Umrah in one travel, you have to slaughter an animal, hadi. طيب, if you don't have the Hajj, if you don't have money, what you should do? فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ فِي الْحَجِّ وَسَبْعَةٍ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ. To fast 3 days in Mecca or in the Hajj time, and 7 when you return. This compulsory, because otherwise the Hajj will be invalid. You have to fast 3 days in Mecca and 7 days in your home. Type, what else in Hajj and Umrah as well? If you break one of the mahdurat, one of the restriction of ihram, like for example, in ihram, you have to wear normal, wear 2 garments for male, and don't add perfume, and don't shave or cut hair, don't clip nail. But if you did, what you should do? You have 3 options. How many? 3 options. First, to fast 3 days. This compulsory. Or to feed 6 maskeen, 6 needy people, and every maskeen half sa'. What is the sa', by the way? Anyone know about the sa'? When you do fitr, sadaqah or charity of fitr, it is 1 sa'. What is sa'? Sa' is 4 mud. What is mud? Mud is a handful of the normal person. If you fill your hand with a rice or a wheat or any kind of grain or any type of food, this is called mud. So if you take 4 handful, it is called 1 sa'. So if you have to feed 6 poor people, we give you mathematics now. 6 people, each one half sa', and each sa' 4 mud. How many mud overall? 6 sa'. So 60 people, each one has to give him half sa', and each sa' 12. Excellent, 12. So because 6 people need half sa' by 6 means 3 sa', and 1 sa' is 4 mud. You have to give them 12 overall, 12 mud. So you fill your hand 12 times with rice and give it to them, or wheat or barley, any kind of food. So this also compulsory. Or you slaughter an animal if you want to compensate that. Type, what else compulsory fasting? If you do an oath, say, wallahi, I will do such and such, and you didn't do, you have to fast. But not from the beginning, be careful. You have to go with the steps. It's not optional here like the previous. The previous example is an optional. This one is in sequence. First one, to set a slave free. But there is no slave now. Next thing, if you don't have a slave, go to the next one, to feed 10 maskeen, 10 needy people. Any kind, one meal. One lunch, one dinner, whatever. Or if you don't have that, to give them an address, a clothes, 10 poor or needy person. Or you fast 3 days. It's the last option, which is be compulsory. Like what else of fasting? Compulsory. Still, we have 3, maybe 4. If someone did a nazr, a vow, nazr that you, like a promise to Allah Azza wa Jal that you fast. You have to fast. It's compulsory. Like, also, if someone killed a Muslim accidentally, he has to compensate that. First, he has to give the diyah for his family. Diyah is an Islamic penalty for the one who killed the other, either by mistake or deliberately. And fast 2 months, not in sequence. 2 months. This is compulsory to compensate that. Also, in zihar. What is zihar? Who knows Surah Al-Mujadala? قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. This surah revealed because the zihar. What is zihar? Zihar, if someone said to his wife, you are forbidden like the back of my mother. You are unlawful, I unlawful to touch you like the back of my mother. This is make her like divorce. But in order to return her, he has to fast 2 months. First, he has to set free the slave or to fast 2 months in sequence. So this is the compulsory fasting so far. What about the optional? I think you know the optionals. Right. Give me an example of the optional fasting.
Ashura,
10th.
Zulhijjah
with Arafah. Yes, what else?
And Monday.
Monday, Thursday. Yes, excellent. Ayyam al-Bid 13, 14, 15, or any 3 days of the month, not necessarily be 13, 14, 15. And Siyam Dawood. Dawood alayhi salam used to fast day and break fast the other day. What else? 6 of Shawwal. What else? Muharram, the 10th, and also Zulhijjah days from the beginning of the days. What else? Do you know the fasting? I think we've finished all. Do you think it's something else left? So far, this is all the optional fasting. So far, there is a lot of fasting you can practice. By the way, especially in the Sha'ban, we are still in Sha'ban. And Sha'ban, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a hadith, ذَاكَ شَهْرٌ يغفل عنه الناس ما بين رجب ورمضان. This month the people neglect this month because it's between Rajab, which is a sacred month, and Ramadan, which is the fast of or fasting, month of the fasting. So what we should do, and we'll finish with that because the time of Salah, what we should do in this month in order to practice ourselves for the month of Ramadan. You can practice fasting wherever you can. Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha qalat, kana an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yasumu sha'bana illa qalila. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fast month of the Sha'ban except few. Wherever you have ability to fast, keep going. Don't look, the people said, there is a hadith said, if the month of Ramadan or if the half of the month of Ramadan reached, no fasting. This is a weak hadith. You can fast any day of Sha'ban, wherever you have the ability, practice from now fasting, because this is the best timing of fasting, because most of the people neglect this month. And when you have a neglection of the ibadah will be more reward. Imagine the people are don't care about the fasting, but you are fasting, this will be more rewarded. So I will stop on this point, inshallah. Just summarize what we mentioned. We mentioned that the fasting is very important to prepare yourself for fasting. And in order to prepare yourself for fasting, you have to do sincere, honest repentance. Sincere that you do this repentance to Allah only. Honest that you will have a trust or have a promise to Allah that you will not return to the sin again. And also you have to be, if someone took from him his right, return him these rights. Second, before you start the month of Ramadan, go to your father and your mother, kiss her, his head, his hand and her hand, and look after for them. And if your father or mother passed away, make dua for them and give charity on behalf of them. Before the month of Ramadan, what you should do? Try to resolve any conflict between you and your brother, any dispute, any argument, any fighting between you and your brother before Ramadan. And before the month of Ramadan, you have to learn the rules of fasting. What is the condition of fasting? What is the pillars of fasting? What is the sunnah act of fasting? In order to get the benefit of fasting, inshallah, this will be every Friday night after Maghrib. We keep going like that until we reach Ramadan. Get ready for Ramadan. Prepare for Ramadan. Inshallah, أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله ولكم وجزاكم الله خيرا for attending. See you inshallah next week. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. Yes, please.
So if someone has, you know, just enough money for Umrah, but not for Hajj. Not for
help,
but for prayer, he has money. So, should he do the Umrah first, or
do
you think he can wait for the
rest of the month? Depends on the opinions of the scholar about the Hajj and Umrah. There are two groups of scholar in this particular point. First said, Umrah is comparable like Hajj. Because Allah, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةِ means complete Hajj and Umrah. Allah combined Hajj and Umrah in one sentence. This one opinions. Second opinion, no, Umrah is only compulsory because Allah, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hadith Abdullah ibn Umar fi Sahihain, that bunya al-Islam ala khams, Islam has been built on five, and one of these five, Hajj, not Umrah. So I prefer the second opinion. So Hajj is a compulsory, Umrah is option. But if you go to Hajj, you have to do Umrah with it. But if you have only money for Umrah and you want to do Hajj, depends on your situation. If you feel that you can wait and prepare the money to Hajj, leave it for Hajj. So this depends on you. You can see your situation. Because I think the difference is much, big difference between Hajj and Umrah now. Maybe double, I think, double. So if you wait for Hajj, it's more better because Hajj is compulsory, but Umrah is not compulsory. But if, I give you another mas'ala maybe for the youth. If you have two options, either to marry, to get marriage, or to do Umrah, or do Hajj. This depends on the person. If you're a young person and you are in a fitna place, you have to marriage first and then do the Hajj, inshallah. Yes? Barakallah fiqh, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.
Allah.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
بارك الله فيك.